Lacan's essay, The Mirror Stage as Formative of the Eye Function. I'll be providing an explanation for the text, so please pause the video and read the text whenever needed. Lacan says that he has already established the idea of mirror stage in a previous session. Now he considers it again in the light of its eye function. Lacan's concept of the mirror stage tries to dramatize how the ego itself becomes divided. This experience is different from any philosophy stemming from the cogito, that is, the principle establishing the existence of a being from the fact of its thinking or awareness, or any principle that believes in the existence of a rational being or a thinking self. Lacan says that human mind is not a unified whole as ego, and any self-knowledge is nothing but an illusion. Mirror stage is not just a passing phase of human psychological development, but a model for the relationship between the I and its image of itself. The human child, at an age when he is superior to chimpanzee in instrumental intelligence, can recognize his own image as such in a mirror. Unlike animals, human beings recognize themselves in the reflected image. This recognition of its image in the mirror is indicated by the illuminative mimicry of the aha alertness. Aha alertness means an experience which gives sudden insight or solution to a problem. It's almost like the Eureka effect. This recognition explains the role of the image in the development of the human psyche. Kohler, that is Wolfgang Kohler, the German psychologist, he considers this to express situational apperception and an essential moment in the act of intelligence. In the field of developmental psychology, one's awareness of one's own position within the physical world and the ability to imagine that position in relation to other physical objects is called situational apperception. Through a series of gestures, the child playfully experiences the relationship between the movements made in the image and the reflected environment, and also between this virtual complex and the reality it duplicates. It is to be noted that this idea of mirror may not be an actual mirror always. Other experiences, like mother's attention to the child, can also give rise to the image of self as a separate entity. This event can take place from the age of 6 months onwards. Lacan quotes Paulvin to support this argument. This idea takes him to the image of a nursling, means a baby that is being breastfed, who has not mastered walking or even standing, who stands with the external help, man or artificial. This nursling adopts a slightly leaning forward position and take in an instantaneous view of the image in order to fix it in his mind. This physical straining of the nursling will become emblematic of the psychological strain of the individual later in his life. Mirror stage happens only up to 18 months. When child acquires language and forms social bonds, mirror stage as a developmental phase comes to an end. But the dynamic relationship between the subject and his image remains a perpetual force in the subject's psychic life. Thus, this event has a specific meaning only up to the age of 18 months. This activity reveals both a libidinal dynamism and an ontological structure of the human world. By libidinal dynamism, it is meant that the psyche invents libido in the image of itself along the line of narcissism. By ontological structure of the human world means the subject having an image of oneself. The mirror stage in this context is an identification. The transformation that takes place in the subject when he or she assumes an image that is seemingly predestined to have an effect at this phase, which Lacan calls imago. During the mirror stage, the child is at the infant stage, trapped in his motor impotence and nursling dependence. Child experiences his body as incomplete and fragmented. However, the image in the mirror is the image of a whole body, a complete entity. The child manifests in an exemplary situation the symbolic matrix in which the I is precipitated in a primordial form. prior to being objectified in the dialectic of identification with the other and before language restores to it its function as subject. This form is called the ideal I, because we haven't learned language or we haven't learned to take the images that the rest of the society has for us. All other self-images occur after we learn language. They are all constructs of the other. This I, that is the ideal I, is untamed because it happens before we acquire language. Since this I is formed in a mirror, it is a fantasy, an unreal image that only seems real. Throughout our life, the image of ourselves that we hold in our minds fail to correspond with our actual physical, historical, emotional being. The child will develop a complex self-image based on his relationship with other people and on the conventions of language. The difference between the projected image of himself and his actual self, however, will continue to disrupt his experience of his own existence in various ways. Primary identification is with the image itself. This identification is fictional. The ideal I will never fully conform to the subject's actual experience of existence. This ideal I will be the rootstock of secondary identifications, and it will be the form which situates the agency known as the ego prior to its social determination. The total form of his body is given to him only as a gestalt. Gestalt means something when considered as a whole has qualities that are more than the total of all its parts. But here the word simply takes its German meaning, that is form, F-O-R-M, form. It appears to him as the contour, that is an outline representing the form, a contour of a stature that freezes it and in a symmetry that reverses it. And so the movements are definitely awkward. This gestalt symbolizes the I's mental permanence. At the same time, it prefigures its alienating destination. This gestalt is replete with the correspondences that unite the I with the statue onto which man projects himself, the phantoms that dominate. The reflected image never exactly correspond to their originals. The wholeness of the reflected body represents to the infant a fixed and stable form, that is gestalt. The image represents the potentialities of the I, but the image is separate from the child. Its potential can never completely be realized. This image is stable and unattainable. It shapes the lives of adult humans, that is in a negative way, resulting in anxieties, disappointments, etc. For imagos, the specular image, that is a mirror image, seems to be the threshold of the visible world. Mind needs this image to organize the visible world. Here Lacan analyzes dreams, hallucinations, etc., which involves the presence of a mental image of the subject's own body. The fact that a gestalt may have formative effects on an organism can be proved by a biological experiment, says Lacan. For the maturation of female pigeon's gonad, that is its sexual maturity, it has to see another member of its species regardless of its sex. Lacan observes that the same effect may be obtained by placing a mirror's reflective field near the individual. Similarly, the migratory locust, that is a kind of tropical grasshopper, it exists in two main phenotypes in response to population density, the solitary phase and the gregarious phase. Solitary phase is usually alone, dull, slow, and it is in fact secluded to itself, whereas the gregarious phase is sociable, colorful, fast, and it is always attracted to other locusts. Scarcity of food may bring them together, and this crowded condition induces gregarization. Otherwise, they prefer to exist in the solitary phase. Some sort of serotonin is released in the central nervous system and it triggers this gregarization. Lacan observes that this can be brought about by exposing an individual at a certain stage of its development to the exclusively visual action of an image akin to its own. Lacan links these observations from biology with aesthetics, suggesting a connection between certain animals' tendencies to respond to visual forms that resemble them. That is homeomorphic identification. And ideas about beauty that are shaped in part by notions of scale and symmetry derived from the dimensions of the human body. This heteromorphic identification, that is, occurring in two or more different forms, especially at different stages in the life cycle, offers insights into the role of visual identification in development. Lacan gives psychological accounts of such physical transformation. It is as valid as the biological explanation, says Lacan. He supports this idea by recalling the radical social theorist Roger Kailoy's concept of legendary psychasthenia. Legendary psychasthenia refers to the ability of some animals to alter their appearance in response to their physical environment, for example, a chameleon. Kailoy's compares this biological phenomenon to psychological experiences of the subject who absorbs into the physical space surrounding them. Here, Lacan explains how psychic events such as identification are connected to physical reality, that is, the body and the physical environment the body occupies. Human knowledge, says Lacan, is more independent than animal knowledge because of the social dialectic. But its limitation is the scanned reality surrealistic unsatisfaction denounces therein. These reflections lead him to the notion that human being experiences an organic inadequacy of his natural reality based on the spatial capture manifested by the mirror stage, and this happens prior to the social dialectic. It happens as an infant and persists throughout our lives.